So it's Friend Day, and we're going to consider the theme of the glory of a true church throughout the morning, and the call to worship, the call to repentance during the sermon and parts of this afternoon. That will be the theme that we'll be talking about, and in that we'll be looking a lot at the book of Colossians, which sometimes is described as one of the most Christ-centered books of the Bible. There is a handout. Tina made copies. I'm not sure where they are, but if someone could find them and hand them out, that would be good. I know she was making copies earlier. So in the Essentials class, most of you have been through it, but some of you may not have, or maybe it was a long time ago. We look at essentials of the faith. We cover things, topics, the gospel, conversion, counting the cost, discipleship, assurance of salvation, sanctification, and so in the course of the classes, church membership is one of the topics, and so we're going to look at that today. If you haven't been through Essentials, you should. If it's been a long time, maybe you should think about. We have some folks in the church who've been here a long time who are going back through it, but it's an amazing blessing to be in a church that will, you know, for people who are either new in the faith or who have come from other churches that weren't good. It's good to just get grounded in the basics. And I know that when I first started coming to church, not here, but in the 90s, I just went years without even understanding the gospel. I had arrived at sort of an intellectual understanding of who Christ is, and had a sense that as long as I didn't disagree with that, well, I must be a Christian and I should join the church. So it would have been helpful to have a class like this, and so I'm grateful that we have it here. I want to just start by reading this passage in Colossians in chapter 1. Christ is the glory of a true church. And in Colossians 1, we see, particularly in verse 18, but I'll read 15 through 20, that Christ is the head of the church. He's the head of this church. So let's just look at that. Chapter 1, Colossians 1, 15. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. You know, you could preach for years on just that. But I wanted to start with just, you know, pointing you to the fact that Christ is the head of this church, He is the glory of a true church. And if we keep the right view of Christ, then we will avoid all kinds of error that threaten to encroach the church. And there is a lot of error when it comes to what is a biblical and correct view of church membership. So let's start with the definition of church membership. And this is drawn from some of the passages that we'll be looking at today. The handout that you're getting is a lesson that Brother Dinger put together. Here he is. So I called him this morning and I said, "Well, where do we attribute this membership definition?" And it's actually one that he put together. So let's look at it. Church membership is a visible expression of one's union with Christ and His bride, whereby a professing follower of Jesus Christ formally commits to join, serve, support, and submit to one local assembly and its leadership, laboring to obey God's will for the edification of the body of Christ and the salvation of the lost to the glory of God. I'm going to repeat that. And we will see the truth of that as we go through this lesson today, but church membership is a visible expression of one's union with Christ and His bride, whereby a professing follower of Christ formally commits to join, serve, support, and submit to one local assembly and its leadership, laboring to obey God's will for the edification of the body of Christ and the salvation of the lost to the glory of God. There's a lot there, and it is countercultural, right? I mean, churches are what pass for churches today. They start with a different gospel, and so they end up with a different idea of what church is. In churches that I have been in before, one of the things that people prized about the church that was that they could remain anonymous, that no one would get in their business, that no one would know whether they had come or whether they had gone. It's a sad thing when that's what is prized about a church. Frankly, that's how First Baptist Orlando is, which is where I came from. 11 years ago, praise God. It's a church of 14,000 that starts with the wrong gospel. The wrong gospel carries out and influences everything else they do. If you start with the right gospel, the true gospel, then the church has a completely different meaning and importance to you. For the unconverted, this definition, this idea of church is foolishness. But for those who have been set apart by God, who are among the few in the history of all of the world and the billions of people who have lived over the centuries, to know that God has set His love on you and orchestrated every detail of your life so that at the time that he appointed, you would hear the gospel, understand the gospel, respond properly to the gospel in repentance and faith, be saved from your enslavement to sin, saved from the eternal torment that you deserve, and to become to possess the righteousness of Christ, without which you have no place in heaven, to receive the promise of fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore. I mean, if that is your experience in salvation, then everything changes, right? You are indwelled by the Spirit of God, and your whole life, your worldview. Did you find them, Noel?
Yes.
Okay. Everything changes, and your desires change, your emotions change, your will changes, and you want to be with the people of God, and you want to worship God, and you want to know God. Because you've been born again. In our weekly Bible study, and which I hope everyone's, you know, trying to make time for either Tuesday or Wednesday nights, Jeffrey Johnson says in the book is "The Church, Why Bother?" And it just, you know, was a happy thing that this week's lesson happened to be on church membership. But he said, "Scripture teaches that when believers are united to Christ by the new birth, they are also mutually united together into one body. This union is not merely symbolic or hypothetical, but is purposeful in the productivity and functioning of every Christian. Christians are interwoven together in such a fashion that they cannot properly function apart from one another." And, you know, if you're genuinely converted, you can't be apart from the body of Christ for a long time without feeling like, you know, things are just not right. You need the other parts of the body for you to function properly. And that's exactly what we read in 1 Corinthians 12. So turn to that, please. 1 Corinthians 12:12, where this metaphor of the body is explained to us by Paul, and it's worth reading the whole passage, 12-26. So 1 Corinthians 12:12, "For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I am not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? If the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I am not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty, but our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. That's just a beautiful and remarkable description of the interdependence that we have as Christians among each other. And there are several metaphors that we see in the Bible for the church. The body certainly is one that helps us to understand, you know, how we're to interact with each other. I know that over the years in being in small group, which I guess here you're doing it here in the church Tuesdays and Thursdays or Wednesdays. On the west side over the years, we've done it in homes. We're going back to homes starting next week. But, you know, there have been people who have come and gone over the years and have been consistent for a time and then been, you know, disappeared. And, you know, when I was trying to exhort them to, you know, to be sure that they were there, to be part of that meeting together during the week, I would always go to this passage, because the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. You cannot function properly as a Christian apart from being connected to the body of Christ. So we do that. I mean, we come here on Sunday mornings and we, you know, listen to the preaching and we sing praises to the Lord and we give as a form of worship. And we do all of those things together, and it's good. And it's just another way in which we can be amazed at the wisdom of God in establishing his church. But in that time, we don't often have the time to talk to each other, to find out what is going on in each other's lives, how I can be praying for someone. Sorry, I've got cotton mouth. It's probably because I'm nervous. So in this church, the philosophy, the way that we try to live these things out, and it's, you know, it's done differently in different churches, but in our church, the way that we have set about trying to obey the scripture in terms of what is the church, how is it supposed to function, we do that, you know, small groups are a big part of what we do. But we take our instruction from Scripture, and I want to take just a second to look at Acts chapter 2. Thank you. Chapter 2, verses 40 and following. So Acts is the history of the church, or the foundation of the church, the first church. And it says in Acts 2:40, "And with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, 'Save yourselves from this crooked generation.' So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." So, does that sound like Cornerstone to you? It is what happens here. You know, we have fellowship together. We have meals together. We study the Word of God together. We pray together. I had been in church for 12 years, I think it was, before I came here. And I had never gotten together with just a group of men to pray. It was just a joy and a privilege and a blessing to, you know, be part of a church where that happens. It doesn't happen everywhere. But we see in this passage, this identifiable people, this group of people who, you know, if you go back to the definition that we started with, formally commit to join, serve, support, and submit to one local assembly. From this point on, they are the apostles and the other disciples are going about fulfilling the Great Commission. This is what they're doing. And what an amazing start, right? 3,000 converts. be amazing to see that happen again. So the Great Commission is something that we have to look at in terms of, you know, what it says about church, what it says about church membership. So turn with me to Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Says, "And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age.'" So in fulfilling that Great Commission, you have to have a church. You can't do it apart from a church and committed members. So you're going to go and make disciples. How are you going to do that? Intentional evangelism, corporate evangelism, the open air preaching at Crane's Roost, missions to Guatemala. These things don't happen. The right way for them to happen is within the structure of a church. It says baptizing them. When you are baptized, you are baptized into a local body. That is, you know, how you publicly profess your commitment and become part of, in this church. You're baptized into the membership of this church. So, you know, we do the evangelism, we do some of the discipling, if there's an opportunity, bring them into the church. When I first started evangelizing years ago in a different church, there was the idea that we didn't want to say to the, we wanted to present the gospel to the people, but we didn't want them to think we were just recruiting, you know, people to our church. Well, that's bad thinking. I mean, I'm recruiting people to this church. You know, when I preach the gospel, I want them to come here and be discipled, because here they'll be properly taught and they will learn to obey all the things that God has commanded. So I'm not ashamed to say, you know, come to Cornerstone. But there's a process, you know, that we have for members to come in. Part of it is going through the essentials class and understanding what we believe, so that they know that what they're joining, and so that by the time they join, they have a clear understanding that they're not coming here to change us. They're coming here to join us and submit to the leadership of this church. And then teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you is, you know, that's what we're doing in this church. We have the small groups, which is, you know, a part of discipleship. I mean, certainly the preaching is part of the discipleship. The essentials class is part of the discipleship. There's a lot of one-on-one discipleship, there's also within that context, we do accountability, which, you know, some people bristle a little at the idea of accountability, but it's interesting because we're going to look next at Matthew 18. And how, you know, that process of discipline helps us to learn to obey all the things that have been commanded by God. But so there is accountability. We are exhorting each other to practice the spiritual disciplines that are means of grace for us. And so we check in with each other. Are you reading your Bible? You know, I mean, a sure sign that, you know, someone is not converted is that they have no desire to know God by reading His Word. You know, how's your prayer life? You know, if you're not praying, you're not having communion with God. You have direct access to the Holy of Holies, which just blows my mind every time I think about it. But to not think that that's worth stopping, and availing yourself of that, and just an incredible privilege. Are you evangelizing? Yeah, this is another thing about accountability that we talk about in small groups. And, you know, again, it's teaching them to obey all the things I've commanded you. The Great Commission is make disciples. It starts with evangelism. If, you know, do you not have a desire to preach the gospel to people? Are you doing it? Do you want to learn? I mean, these are all things that we talk about in small group, and it's, you know, the mark of a Christian. I mean, if the pattern of your life is that you don't evangelize, then you really need to examine yourself. You don't understand the gospel. So there's you know, everything that we do here is designed to teach the people in this church how to obey all the things that God has commanded. You know, apart from a church, you can't do that. Apart from your commitment to be here, you can't do that. And, you know, he says in the end of this, I am with you always. And what we're teaching here is dependence on the Lord. You can't do all of these things in your own strength. You can't just sort of fake it. Although people try. You know, repentance, impossible apart from the Spirit of God working in you. Even evangelism, you know, I mean, you can force yourself out there and you can go through the motions, but if you want God to bless what you're doing, you need to do it prayerfully, you know, not relying on your own strength, but relying on the Spirit of God to work through you. So the Great Commission is worked out in the church, which, you know, praise God we're here in a church where this actually happens. I want to refer back again to Jeff Johnson's book. If you don't have it, I mean, I think there's copies out here, but on page 110, you know, he elaborates on how we are to interact with one another in the church. And these are responsibilities of church membership that you don't see in a mega church usually. Or, you know, sometimes it's even a small church. They don't understand the responsibility that we have to each other, to exhort each other and encourage each other and love each other. And I'm just going to read briefly through this on page 110. He's got several sections. He talks about our responsibilities toward God, responsibilities toward one another, responsibilities toward the elders, responsibilities toward unbelievers. But I want to look specifically now at the responsibilities toward one another. Does everybody have this book? Are you reading this book? Good. Responsibilities toward one another. We're to be active in loving one another. I'm not going to read all of these scripture references that he has here, but I encourage you to do that. Active in accountability, and in that, submitting to one another, edifying one another, exhorting one another, admonishing one another, and if necessary, following through with church discipline. Responsibilities include being active in fellowshipping with one another, caring for one another, attending the assemblies of the church with one another, and supporting the work of the ministry. You know, look at your life, look at yourself, look at how you're interacting with the church, and, you know, are you obeying these commands of Scripture to do these things? You know, sometimes, you know, a new Christian comes in and is just all fired up and, yeah, you know, we're going to do all these things. And they do. And then over time, you know, you sort of lose some of that initial zeal. And so I'm here to exhort you to not do that. You know, your growth and maturity is at stake, but so is the growth and maturity of the other people in this church to whom you have a responsibility. A couple of weeks ago, when we were reading the chapter on worship, it was awesome. I learned a lot as we went through that chapter. But one of the things about worship that I hadn't really thought about until I read this book was that we come in to sing and worship in the context of singing praises to God, right? So that is one way in which we worship. And there's something real special about that, because we know that right now in heaven there are real people singing real songs to our real God. And when we worship God here in this church, we are joining that heavenly choir. And it's just amazing, right? But there's something else that we're doing, and that is edifying each other in song. So you may have noticed in the last few months, at least one of the songs that we sing on Sunday mornings, they've toned down the music quite a bit, so that really all you can hear are the voices of the people here singing. And that is an encouragement to hear, you know, our fellow believers here in this church singing praises to God. And it should cause you to worship in song more robustly than perhaps you normally do. You're edifying each other when you're singing. Did you think of that? So that's what that's part of what we're doing all the time in church. I mean, that's what these one another's are about. We are here to, you know, help each other get through the challenges of this life, focusing on Christ our Savior, and exhorting each other so that we might persevere to the end and get to heaven. I mean, we have that responsibility to each other. And so that kind of brings us to, I wanted to point your attention to the 1689, which as I was thinking about this class and thinking about church and, the biblical mandate for being a member of a local church, I looked at section 26, which is on the church. And I was surprised, to be honest, that when you read section 26 in chapter 5, I'll read it to you. If you don't have this, I think there's some on the shelf. You really ought to read the confession. This is sort of a synthesis of, our understanding of what the Bible says about how we should live and the doctrines that it teaches. Chapter 5 says, "In the exercise of the authority which has been entrusted to him, the Lord Jesus calls to himself from out of the world through the ministry of his word, by his Spirit, those who are given to him by his Father, so that they may walk before him in all the ways of obedience which he prescribes to them in his word. Those who are thus called, he commands to walk together in particular societies or churches for their mutual edification and for the due performance of that public worship which he requires of them in the world. So if you read this, and I know many of you are familiar with it, the proof text for this passage is Matthew 18, 15 through 20, which is the one that we all know is about church discipline. And it helped me to understand, as I considered the fact that, you know, that's the text in which they're supporting the idea that you know, we are responsible and commanded to walk together in particular churches, comes from the text on church discipline. Why? I'm going to. There's an exposition of this confession that Sam Walden wrote. It's a modern exposition of the 1689. Well, first let me read just 15 through 17. It says, "Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector." So, as a proof text for why you should be in church, this is what the exposition of the 1689 says. "This precept, people walking together in churches, creates the structure or context in which the Great Commission is carried out. Jesus desires that his disciples be taught to observe all that he commanded. How shall this be accomplished? By the creation of local churches with local teacher elders. Jesus commands such churches in this passage. If Jesus commands that offenses be brought to the church and commands the church to rebuke such offenses and ultimately to exclude the impenitent, then necessarily he commands the existence of such local churches. The stated purpose of the church in this passage is to teach an erring member one of Christ's commands by calling him to repentance and, if necessary, by its disciplinary action." So again, here we have a responsibility to one another. And it is not, you are not fulfilling that responsibility if you do not speak to a brother who is either in sin or has sinned against you. And, you know, for the most part, that doesn't happen in churches. I mean, you know, it's everything from, you know, you shouldn't judge me, and you don't get in my business, and, you know, all kinds of things are said. But the loving thing to do is to go to your brother and to, you know, call him to repent from sin. And this is how, one of the ways in which we are taught to obey all of the things that God has commanded us to do. My mindset about discipline is, you know, hasn't been so much that it is just a part of the way we're to operate, the way we're to function, the way we're to interact. You know, usually when you think of church discipline, it's some monstrous, horrible thing that, but part of the wisdom is dealing with things before they become monstrous and horrible. What I read Calvin's commentary on this passage, and it was really helpful. And I would encourage all of you to look at it, because, and I'm not going to read the whole thing here. By the way, you can get all of Calvin's commentary for $3.99 in the Play Store, which just boggles my mind too. But so Calvin's commentary on this section is helpful in understanding just the delicate nature of this process of holding each other accountable and of rebuking each other when it's necessary. He gives just a nice description of the wisdom of God and how He's laid out these steps, and it's a step. It's a process, and what He's saying in effect is we need to speak the truth in love to each other. And in that process, we can all learn from each other how to obey all the things that God has commanded us. Part of that process, and this is another thing that, a church discipline in general, it isn't practiced. The general perception is it's just a mean-spirited, hateful thing to do. Why would you? Well, you would because God said to. But He also says that, part of church membership is when you come into a church, you are submitting yourself to its leadership. And there's, clear instruction on that. If you look at Hebrews 13:7 and Hebrews 13:17, it says, "Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith." And in 17, he says, "Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you." We are rebels by nature. And, when somebody says to you, submit, it doesn't come naturally to you. But it is, you need to practice submission as a way of learning to submit to the Lord. That doesn't mean submitting to abusive, unreasonable, sometimes unconverted leaders. We're talking about doing this in the context of a real church. And so there's instruction to the leaders. In 1 Peter 5, 1 through 5, he says, "So I exhort the elders among you, as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory." All of these things inform, what church membership involves. And it's a very different thing than just church attendance. We're glad that people come and attend our church. We want them to become members of our church so that they can understand how they're to live as Christians. You're just hard pressed to do that in the way that God meant for us to love each other and to love him outside of a church. In the last two sections here from Romans, we see the instruction of how we're to live, how we're to live together, love each other. Exercising, our spiritual gifts with each other. I'll just look at Romans 12, verses 9 through 16. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. So I hope that is helpful to you, and I hope that it causes you to be more grateful to God for having established this church and brought you to it. So let's pray. Father in heaven, we are grateful for your kindness toward us in so many ways, and we are amazed at your wisdom and how you've done just what we need in establishing your church and given us clear instruction on how to order it and how to glorify you through it. We just pray your blessing on the rest of our time this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.